Welcome to our second live stream of the day. This one is a little bit more spontaneous, and I'm a super spontaneous person, so I am pumped to be bringing to you guys in the Lee Valley Tools YouTube channel another virtual workshop. But today, and this workshop, I guess I can't even say today because it's our second one of the day, but this workshop is going to be our virtual terrarium workshop. We are at the Ottawa Home and Garden Show all weekend long with the Urban Botanist. That's me, Emma, your host of other Lee Valley Tools workshops. And this workshop today, we have a live audience for once in like, I don't know, 2 years. I'm so excited to have people like that I can actually talk to. I'm so pumped. I mean, it's great chatting to a screen, to a camera. And for those of you who are tuning in virtually, welcome. We are so happy to have you here as well. Ask questions. Let us know where you're tuning in from. Our production team is going to be communicating with me. So if you've got questions, type them on into the chat and let me know. Same with our in-person crowd here. If you've got questions at any point throughout the workshop, raise your hand, holler, interrupt me, all good. All is good. But as I mentioned, we're doing a terrarium workshop today. Has anybody here, I know I already asked you guys, but anyone at home made a terrarium before? Ever heard of a terrarium? Has some people heard the word terrarium for the first time? Couple people maybe? And I kind of like to start out there as like, what is a terrarium? What does it mean? What exactly is a terrarium? That's a good question. And really, I kind of like to break it down in that a terrarium is a terrestrial version of an aquarium. Does that make sense? Light bulbs going off, light bulbs at home. A terrarium is basically like a snapshot of an ecosystem captured inside of a glass vessel. It's the art of recreating a naturally existing habitat inside of a groovy glass vessel. There's so many different ways that you can make terrariums with the different types of glassware and plants and everything in between. So that is really what a terrarium is. And why I love terrariums is because I find it's a really great way to garden under glass, get creative, you know, kind of interact with nature indoors. And that's really what the Urban Botanist is all about, is inspiring people to engage with nature in an urban setting. So that's really what a terrarium is. Now, there are two different types of terrariums. All terrariums fall into one of these two categories. There are open terrariums, which is what we're going to be making today. We're going to be using succulents. And then there are sealed terrariums, like this guy here. And really the main difference between these two types, apart from, of course, one has a lid and one doesn't, are really the types of plants that you can put inside of each of these terrariums. You can imagine that this type of a terrarium is creating a totally different ecosystem or a totally different habitat than this open terrarium here. This is gonna be really capturing and locking in moisture. So the types of plants that go really well inside of a sealed terrarium are going to be your ferns, your mosses, phytonias, calatheas, plants that love high humidity for them, that allows that ecosystem to dry out. If you think about a succulent, it doesn't like being watered every day. It doesn't even like being watered every week. It likes being dry. So that being said, do you think we'd put a succulent inside of a sealed terrarium? No, definitely not. It would last like less than a week, I would say, and it would just shrivel up and turn black and be like so miserable and like, bye. Thanks, but no thanks. This is not my jam. So we're using succulents for our open terrariums today in this workshop. And we also have a few different tools that we're going to be using as well. I'm gonna walk around just a little bit so I can pick up some of these items to show you folks. But the thing with terrariums that I find is the most important is the tools. Using tools for terrarium making can really make or break your terrarium experience. And we've all got tools on our tables, and I'm gonna teach you guys at home some of the tools that I like to recommend when you're getting into terrarium making. These tools are going to work as extensions of your fingertips. So kind of getting into those really hard to reach spots. Our trowels are gonna be really great for adding soil into those hard to reach places. We've also got some tweezers. We've got these guys here. They're not entirely necessary, but we've got them. I'll grab a pair for your guys' table. We've all got a cork stomper. I'm gonna grab some for your table too. But these guys here are great for kind of packing that soil in and around the base of the plant, kind of getting into those hard to reach spots. That's what these are for there, okay? So those are really helpful. Other tools that I've used in the past have been like funnels. You can DIY a lot of your tools. Even barbecue skewers are great for getting into some of those hard to reach spots as well. I'm gonna grab the succulents for our in-person group. And for those of you at home, you can always use small plants. Small plants are ideal for terrariums. Of course, we're working in a small space. We want to use small plants. I love using succulents because they grow slow. They are very, very slow growers. So if you're not noticing all that much growth from your succulents in the next few weeks, few months, not to worry. It's totally normal. Totally normal. Okay, so I'm just gonna give out some succulents here. You guys wanna choose one of these plants for your terrarium? Yes, that one is my favorite. Here, I'll pull it out for you. They're a little bit sticky. There you go. Evelyn, you'd like to choose one for yourself? This guy here? Perfect, there you go. These tweezers are for you to use. You guys both have some tweezers, awesome. And go ahead and choose your succulents as well. I'm gonna choose one each. This guy here, which one's calling your name? Yeah, good choice, there you go. I love using succulents. They have this beautiful color to them and they grow very slowly, as I mentioned. So we love to use succulents inside of open terrariums only, but they work really well for that. Okay. Some other things that you want to think about whenever you're making a terrarium. Of course, this process is going to be a little bit different than if you were to be making a sealed terrarium, but we're going to end up with something beautiful like this. And of course, there's no wrong or right way to decorate your terrarium. You decorate it however you want, but we're going to dive on into it. We're going to get into really just the basics, the foundation. This is sort of like a beginner terrarium, if you will. There are so many more elaborate ways to make terrariums with the different like layers, the different types of plants, the different decor. Like there is just a limitless number of ways that you can make these glass gardens. And it's become such a huge hobby of mine that hopefully you guys at home will feel inspired to maybe upcycle a piece of glassware that you have that's just collecting dust in your kitchen and your cabinets. If it can hold soil, it can be a terrarium, pretty much. What we're gonna start out with first is we can all go ahead and grab our shovels, our trowels, and we're going to, using our gravel that we've all got on our table, and for those of you at home, this is a pea stone gravel, and we're going to start to add about 2 to 3 scoops of gravel to the bottom of our terrariums, okay? So you wanna make sure that you're adding enough to the point where you're not able to, you've had enough so that there's the whole bottom, the whole base of your terrarium is covered. So you should end up with something like this. Not too high, you don't need to add too much, but just enough that your base is completely covered. Now, why are we adding this gravel to the bottom of our terrarium? Drainage, that's right. Lee nailed it. She knows what's up. What is drainage? We know what drainage is, at least most of us probably do. If you take a look at the bottom of your succulent, see those holes in the bottom of your potted plant? Those holes are called drainage holes, and they're vital for excess water to be able to drip down, out, and away from the roof so that those roots aren't just sitting in excess water for too long. So we have those drainage holes. Now, because we can't drill holes in the bottom of our glassware, we do this instead. We create what's called a false bottom or a drainage layer in our terrarium. So that's really essential, really, really key when you're making terrariums at home. If you're making a terrarium, you've got to create some sort of a drainage layer. Even sand can work quite well, but you want to use an untreated type of a stone. So this is just river rock. So that's step one. Guys, did I not tell you this was going to be easy? Step one is done. Gold star, A+, A+++ for you at home if you're following along. Easy breezy. All right, we're going to move into our next step, which is going to be with our soil. All right. I am using a cactus and succulent grade soil. So this soil has quite a bit of perlite mixed in. It's got some sand that's been mixed into the soil. So it's got really good drainage, essentially, which these plants are going to appreciate. It's really important to use soil that has good drainage when you're potting up succulents or cacti. So, and for those of you at home who are maybe using a different type of plant for your terrarium and you're wondering, what type of soil do I use for my terrarium? What type of plant are you using? It's all going to be based on the plant. If you're using African violets, use an African violet-based soil. So something to that degree will be perfect. All right, so let's start filling up our terrariums. Let's start filling up our terrarium. So we're going to fill it up. I kind of like to go slow. We're going to fill up our terrariums to about halfway. All right, so add enough soil to the point where you're just about halfway, not too high. And you don't need to pack your soil down too tightly, but just slightly, you know, just ever so slightly. And what we want to try to create or maintain is just a nice flat landscape. We kind of want our landscape of our terrarium to be one flat, smooth layer. So we don't really want any mountains. We don't really want any ditches. It shouldn't look like the Mogul Hill at the ski resort. It should just be like a nice flat layer, if that makes sense, okay? You don't need to pack it down too tightly either, because we really want to keep those little pockets of air in our soil mixture, because the roots of our plants need oxygen too. They do. They need oxygen, otherwise they're gonna get suffocated and it's no good. All right, so you want it to be about halfway. The best way to tell if you've added sufficient soil to whatever your vessel is you wanna take your plant and kind of put it right side by side to your vessel and make sure that the level of soil inside of your terrarium is at the same height as your potted plant. That's a great way to tell. Yours is perfect right here, if you've added sufficient soil. So that's obviously really important. We want to make sure that our plants aren't running out of space, aren't running out of room inside of our terrariums. So make sure that you've added sufficient soil, and that's going to be perfect for you, okay? That is the best way to tell, because obviously, depending on the vessel you're using, it's going to be a different amount of soil. So that's the best way to tell. All right, so it should be a nice flat landscape, a nice flat, smooth top layer. Should be looking a little something like this right now. You can use your knuckles to kind of just gently pack it down. And as I mentioned, it should be one flat, smooth layer. Looking good so far? Yes, they're looking good. Good, 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 good. Super. Okay, what we're gonna do next is we're going to decide where we want to plant our succulents inside of our terrarium. So really the best place to go is right smack dab in the middle for this shape of glassware, for the shape of succulents too. So we're gonna go right in the middle. We can use our trowels again and just kind of, I kind of do a sweeping motion. You wanna kind of create a pocket, a little hole that's about the same shape and depth as our root system here. That's about as big, as deep as you want it to be. If you're hitting that gravel layer, that's okay. But just kind of create a nice little circle for your terrarium to fit into. All right? Not for your terrarium to fit into. What am I saying? For your succulent to fit into. We're going to put a terrarium inside of a terrarium, guys. Just wait. That's actually what's going to happen. Actually, we will be doing that. Just wait. We might be throwing that on in there. All right. So what you should have is just like a little hole. Pretty straightforward. And then I think I'm going to use this guy. No, I'm going to use this guy. Now what we're going to do is remove our plant from its pot. It should come right up and out, but if not, you can just hold the edges and kind of give it a pinch. Pinch, pinch, pinch. Lift your succulent up and out of its pot. Okay. You can put your nursery pot off to the side a little bit. Now, before we place our plant inside the hole, I know it's like automatic, let's just get it in there. But what we want to do first is what's commonly called massaging the root ball. So you can do that either over your soil bin or over your terrarium, it's all good. You kind of just want to break up some of that old soil, loosening up the roots. This is really important. Whenever you are repotting a plant, essentially we are repotting these succulents. We want to loosen up these roots. We want to kind of give them a little bit more mobility, a little bit more freedom, a little bit more movement. And also it kind of helps to remove some of that old stagnant soil. Introducing some oxygen in between the roots, which is super important. So kind of just doing this, being very gentle to not snap too many of the roots. Also a good opportunity to remove any dead or dying leaves, should your succulent have any. I'm gonna go ahead and do that with mine. This is like a good little moment to just do some self-care for your succulent. Remove any dead or dying leaves. Those are not important anymore. If ever you're seeing dead, crispy, or dying leaves on the bottom of your succulent, that's okay. That's normal. That's kind of like a snake almost shedding its skin. Those are the oldest leaves on the plant, and they're just kind of getting rid of them, okay? So now you should kind of end up with something that looks like this. Got a lot of the roots loose, which is perfect. And then we're going to go and gently place our succulent inside of that little pocket that we just dug out for it. All right, so you can place that guy in there. Should just sit right perfectly inside of your terrarium, just like that. And you can use either your cork stomper, you can use the back end of your shovel here, you can use your fingers, and you're really just now trying to work that existing soil inside of your terrarium in and around the base of your plant. You really want to get it in there. You want to provide good structure, good support, so that your plant isn't bobbling around or moving around too much inside of your terrarium, okay? And you're probably going to end up with a nice ditch inside of your terrarium, but that's okay. You can go in and add extra soil, that's fine. But right now what we're focusing on is really getting that plant feeling good and secure inside of our terrarium. So it's a little tricky because we're working in a confined space, but take your time. This is arguably the hardest part of the workshop, so take your time with it, all right? Take your time. I'm just kind of packing my soil in and around the base of my plant just to get it really anchored in there. I'm going to take my finger and kind of just like wipe it along the inside of my terrarium to brush down any dirt that's getting stuck to the edge, just kind of like this. Yeah, exactly. And then what you can do is go back to your soil and fill in that little moat that you've probably kind of created around the outside. And I really like to use a small amount of soil at a time. It's a lot more easy to control if you just fill up a tiny little bit of your shovel, just a little tiny bit at a time. Slowly work your way around your terrarium. I find it's always good to give it a spin so you can see every angle of what's going on. Sometimes it's even good to get down at like eye level and see what maybe it's missing, or even picking your terrarium up at eye level and giving it a look to see, maybe I could add a little bit more soil or make soil, because really what we are now working to accomplish is not only anchoring our succulents into our terrarium, but really bringing that soil layer and level up to one nice, smooth, flat landscape. Okay. A funnel would really come in handy too. That's another one of my tools that I love using in some of the more elaborate pieces of glassware that I've worked with. Some of those like Cardiff, those old like wine containers that have a really thin nozzle. You really got to use your tools when you're working with that type of glassware. There's no other way to do it. There just isn't. But it makes it fun. It really does. It kind of adds to it. But so it should be getting right around to the point where your landscape is looking quite smooth. Maybe you need to rub your index finger along the inside just to sort of brush down any of that soil. If you're at home joining us, you can use a paintbrush. Small paintbrush would work really well. There's a limitless number of tools that probably already exist in your household that you could use for terrariums. I mean, some of the tools that we're using here is a barbecue skewer with a cork, or a, it is cork. It's a wine cork, wine bottle cork, just stuck on top. And that's great for kind of packing down or tamping down the soil. That works really well too. That's what the tools are there for. The slower, the better. It's always easier to add more than to take out if you've added too much. So just take your time with it. And you should end up with something that looks a little like this. You'll notice my soil's at one nice flat layer. My plant's not sticking up and out of the terrarium. It's kind of right smack dab in the middle. It's at the perfect level. Everyone's is looking fabulous so far. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Now the next part of creating a terrarium, the next part of our workshop here today at the Lee Valley Tools Urban Botanist booth, is we're going to now bring our terrariums to life. This is my favorite part. This is really where the art or the craft of terrarium making comes from, is adding our own personal touches, our own little pieces of flair to really bring the piece to life, to have it tell a story. So we've got a few different ingredients that we're gonna be working with here. I'm gonna grab some from one of these tables. You guys have moss, awesome. We're going to be, at least today, working with preserved moss. This is reindeer moss. We've got a few different colors, different shades. You can use as little or as much as you like. Whenever you're creating a terrarium, I always find it's easier to add more than it is to take out. So go slowly, start to just fill in little gaps, little spaces. I like to sort of rip this moss. You can break it up into small pieces. You can use your tweezers to add it in. You can use your fingers. I kind of like just plugging it in to little spots here, almost creating like a bush, like little bushes. But you can add as little or as much as you like. This is preserved reindeer moss. It's not living, okay? So you don't have to worry about watering it. It will never die, decay, mold, fade. It's perfect for open terrariums. I would never use preserved moss inside of a sealed terrarium. Sealed terrariums are a lot more finicky. You have to use mainly organic and living materials inside of a living terrarium because it's an enclosed system. And a lot more can go wrong. But with our open terrariums, they're perfect. They're great. We are easy breezy. But I love adding moss. I find it adds a beautiful pop of color, really nice textural dimension to a terrarium. So I typically like to add my moss first. It just like makes sense inside of a terrarium for me. You can add some on either side of your plant. You can build up one half of your terrarium. Like, there truly is no wrong way to decorate. Do whatever feels right. Let your creativity flow and just connect with nature. Connect. Some other materials that I have here and that we all have here at our workshop here at the Home and Garden Show is we've got some decorative stones. That's sort of what I like to work with next. Okay, we've got some beautiful polished decorative stones. I kind of like to lay those down. I find it creates like a nice blank canvas to build upon. So you can add some of these polished stones. You can add a little piece of wood. I kind of like to add little figurines. Last, I like to save those sort of accent pieces or your little, your final pieces, your aesthetical final pieces, your little final touches. I like to save those last to plug them in a little spot that might be missing a certain something. But as I said, there's no wrong way. Some of the other cool little decorative materials that we have here, we've got little gnomes, little garden gnomes, like, come on, so cute. So cute. I love adding figurines to terrariums. I find it just like brings the terrarium to life. I love frogs, so I'm gonna add a frog to mine. This is like my poison arrow dart frog. Maybe I'll have him like hanging off the edge or something. Or I'll just place him on some moss. We've got these little tiny toadstools. I'm obsessed. They're so cute. Add your own little touches. Add whatever makes sense for you, okay? To really tell a story. If you've got your own little personal pieces of maybe driftwood or shells or coral from maybe a trip that you took where you did some beach combing and you collected all these pieces and you're like, oh, I don't know when on earth I'm going to use all these things. Well, here's an opportunity for you to use some of those things. You can add your own little personal touch. A few years ago, my mom and I went to Costa Rica. And we had a beach combing day and came home with all those little pieces. And I made her a Costa Rica themed terrarium for her birthday. It was like such a cute way to kind of preserve a memory and bring that personal touch And it makes a beautiful gift. I love giving terrariums as gifts. I say they're the gift that keeps on growing. They're a lot nicer, in my opinion, than flowers, but don't get me wrong, I love flowers. I'll leave my address in the link below. You can send them my way. But terrariums over flowers any day, all day. And yeah, you can add your own little touch. And even something that I like to do around the holidays, we've got some groovy little, we've got mini bunny rabbits here. We've got tiny little carrots. For Easter, you know, whatever the holidays might look like for you, you can add a little pop of red, a little touch of blue, and then boom, your terrarium is holiday themed. It's like, it's awesome. So it's very easy for you to change up your terrarium depending on the time of year. And then the holidays are over, you pluck that little piece out, and then it's no longer holiday themed. They make a beautiful centerpiece for your dining room table. I kind of like to work to cover the soil completely, but that's just me. Maybe you like the look of the soil poking through, and that's fine. As I said, there's no wrong way to decorate your terrarium. It's whatever makes sense to you. I've got this beautiful stone, and we've got these tiny little ladybugs that have a sticky backing on them. And I'm going to stick that little ladybug onto my rock. You could stick it onto a piece of wood. We've got cute little pieces of wood here too that you can add. I'm gonna add that to my terrarium. I love bugs. If you guys know me, you know I love bugs. Bugs and frogs are my jam. It's coming together really nicely. I've got these cute little messages in a bottle you guys can use. I've seen people, you know, take the message out, write a little note on it. I've seen people take it out, add a little bit of soil, add a little bit of moss, create like a mini terrarium. Look at this, how cute is this? A mini terrarium inside a terrarium? I know, I did it. You didn't think I was gonna do it, but I did it. It's like a terrarium inception. It's happening here at the Lee Valley Tools Urban Botanist booth. We have a question from our virtual attendees. Yes. Okay, we have a question about watering terrariums. We're gonna be talking about that next, I promise, because of course, all of our fabulous attendees in person here are gonna wanna know how to water their terrariums. We got it, we got you. I promise we're getting to it. We're still decorating. We're still decorating. I could spend just like countless hours decorating my terrariums. I actually love this. Look at how cute. It looks like seaweed or something. Like, doesn't that look like coral? I love it. So get creative. Do whatever feels right. This is your opportunity to let your creative juices flow. If you get to the point where you're not quite sure what more it needs, then maybe you're done. Maybe it doesn't need anything more. But you can go over with your tweezers and do some fine tuning. And in the meantime, I'm going to talk a little bit about care. We're going to talk about watering. We're going to talk about sunlight. We're going to talk about all things care for our terrariums. Okay? So the care for your terrarium is going to be different depending on what type of plant you're using. So because we're using succulents, I'm going to be talking about succulent care. But if you're using African violets, if you're using ferns, if you're using calatheas, spetonias, peperomias, those are all really great plants for terrariums because they grow small. They've got tiny leaves. You want to use plants that stay small in terrariums, obviously, because you don't want to use a Monstera deliciosa or a pothos or something that's going to get huge and wild and crazy if it isn't already by the time you've bought it. So you need to stick with small plants. And that's why I use succulents, because they are usually small and they stay small for a while. They grow slowly, as we've already mentioned. But when it comes to watering our terrariums here today, first and foremost, everyone's got a little circular card at their workstations. That's for you to take home. That's got your terrarium care information on the back. Okay, so pop that into your boxes to take home with you, but I will talk about care. When it comes to watering, we want to think about our succulents, right? Whenever you're thinking about watering or the care for any of your houseplants at home, you want to go back to their natural history. Where does this plant naturally live? Where does it live? Do these live in the Amazon rainforest? No. Do they live in Canadian forests here? No. They live southern US. You see them a lot in California. You see them in Mexico. They are a very dry and arid ecosystem-loving plant. So keeping that in mind, how often do you think we're going to water a plant that loves being dry? Or how often does it rain does it rain in the desert is something that I like to say. Does it rain every day in the desert? No, it doesn't. It doesn't even rain every week, does it? It rains, like Lee says, once a year. Sure, let's go with that. I'd rather go with that than every day. It rains like maybe once every 6 weeks. It doesn't rain very often. So keeping that in mind with our succulent terrariums, are we gonna water them every day? No. We're not even gonna water them every week. We're going to water them like once every 6 weeks or when the soil has totally dried out. That's gonna be the best thing to do for your succulents is when that soil is totally dry, that is your sign to water for succulents. Soil's dry, time to water. My rule of thumb with succulents is when in doubt, don't water. If you're like, should I? I could, maybe it's today. Don't. Just don't. I promise you, they are much happier to go for longer periods of time without water than with too much water for too long. Truly, they are happy. Look at their big, thick, fleshy bodies. Look at that. That is an evolutionary adaptation. That is a sign that these plants can go for very long periods of time without being watered. Those are water reserves. That is like, each one is like a camel's hump. It's storing water. So you don't need to water these every day. And that's how often we're gonna water our terrariums, is like maybe once a month. Air moisture? That's a good question. The question is, what about air moisture? If we've got a humidifier in the area, how would that impact our terrariums? It would just mean that it would probably take quite a bit longer for your soil to dry out. And really, you only want to water your succulents when the soil has dried out. Now, how can you tell if the soil's dry? Stick your finger in. Stick your finger in or do a visual inspection. Does the soil look really light in color? Does it feel really light? We're going to water our terrariums after the live stream ends, but I'm going to do a demonstration on how to water our terrariums here. I like to use a bottle that has a little bit of a nozzle on it. These are very inexpensive and easy to find. You can even repurpose a Gatorade bottle. You can repurpose a mustard bottle. But I love using something with a controlled nozzle, especially with terrariums when we've done all this fine work. You know, you've just spent all this time decorating your piece and you don't want to go and like pour water on it, like disrupts your design. So what I like to do is I love a controlled bottle and I like to get in down close to the base of the plant. I don't like to water the plant itself, even though this isn't the end of the world. If you get water on your succulent, it is fine. I do like to avoid it though, because if you can see, the water is pooling on the top of the succulent. See how it's pooling? Usually these plants are very efficient, and even you can see the way that they're shaped. They're shaped almost on an angle. That's acting as a drainage system. It's to drain the water down towards the base of the plant and then down to the soil so that the roots can absorb that water. Plants absorb water through their roots. They seldom, or not really efficiently at least, absorb water through their leaves. It's through the roots. So let's try to direct that water flow to the roots. So I like to go right down towards the base of the plant with my bottle. And I like to give a good deep watering. Let's go back to the desert mentally. Mentally, we're in the desert. Hopefully not too far away from margaritas or a source of water. When it rains in the desert, does it kind of just like little rain shower, a little bloop? It pours. It comes down and it comes down hard. And that's the exact method that we want to use for our succulents and our cacti. We want to give them a good, deep watering because we're not going to water it again for another 6 weeks. We want to give it time to let that soil totally dry out. So when you're watering your terrariums, you're going to bring them home, water them. We can water them right now, but you can absolutely water them when you get home. But you're going to want to use about 200 milliliters of water, okay? Give or take, it depends on your size of your vessel. But you want to think about, at least if you're working with succulents, really moistening that soil all the way through. All the soil should be good and moistened so that You're not watering again for another several weeks. And everyone's space is different. My space may have more natural light than Lee's space. Maybe you've got more humidity. Maybe Ron, maybe you've got more dryness in your space. Maybe you've got a smaller space, a larger space. Everyone's space is different. And our plants are always evolving and adapting to our spaces. So it's really gonna be dependent on your space. This is just a guideline. So for sunlight, great question. You wanna place your terrarium for this type of plant at least, depending on what type of your terrarium you're making. Succulents really like bright, indirect light. They don't need direct sun, but a bright space is perfect. A bright spot is ideal. Low light, not so good. So if you can find a bright spot to place your terrariums, they'll be happy for at least 6 hours a day. If it's getting bright light for at least 6 hours, that's perfect. Okay, make sense? Questions, you guys have any questions about terrariums, about your succulents? Let me know virtually if you've got questions at home, whether you're tuning in on Facebook, tuning in on YouTube. I don't know, are we live on Twitch as well? We're live on all the things today. We're going crazy. We got lots of people here too. Lee's got a question. Okay. So Lee has a succulent at home that's gotten really long, really leggy. Has anyone experienced that too, where your succulents are kind of growing in this like weird Dr. Seuss kind of like way? That's called ateliating or teliation, where your plant's not getting enough sunlight. So it's reaching for the sun. So whenever I see that happening, I A, try to move my plant to a place where it's gonna get more sunlight. And also, depending on how weird the growth has become, you can cut the plant. You can take a cutting where you cut off the head, stick it in soil, the rest of the plant will continue to grow, and that piece that you cut off will grow roots and grow too. Can add some structural support, a bamboo stick, something to help support it. But yeah, that's typically a sign of not enough sunlight when your plant is kind of like growing weird, like doing a dance. That's when it's not getting enough sun. Great question. Great, great question. Well, if we don't have any other questions, we do all have our cards here. And for you at home, if you do have questions, send me a DM. I'm at The Urban Botanist on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube. I'm on all the things. You can also message Lee Valley Tools. The questions will get to me some way, shape, or form. Thank you so much for tuning in virtually, and we will see you in the next video. Bye.